endure this. But one of the great contributions that is unique to Christianity is the invention of what we call theology. Now, other religions now have their theologians, but it begins with Christianity. And this phenomenon of what we call theology is the result of the Christ event. The Christ event is that moment in history when the disciples of Jesus, when they encountered him, were they believed they were encountering the divine. And it's really quite extraordinary. So when we talk about the Christ event, we're talking about the life of Jesus, and we're also talking about his teaching and his suffering and his death and his resurrection. And then, after reflecting upon that experience, then they came up with the idea of the incarnation, which is a theological idea. So after having the experience of Jesus or the Christ event, then people who were having this experience were asking the question, what does this mean? What is the implications of what we just experienced? And so one of the classic definitions of theology is faith seeking understanding. So faith is prior to understanding. So it's not like when you enter into a Christian experience. Well, I don't want to sound redundant here. It is not like Christianity is a philosophical system of ideas that you buy into. It's not an ideology. Christianity is a person. It is Jesus of Nazareth and what you experience of God through Jesus of Nazareth, either through a direct experience of him as a person, as the original disciples had, or by it being transmitted to you through the body of disciples, which is called the church. So Christianity is an experience of God through the person of Jesus. That's why you cannot have a Christless Christianity. Everything has to do and is connected with the person of Jesus. So you have the Christ event, and then people started thinking over time, what does this mean? And very early on, there are two traditions that converge in the church. There is the tradition of rabbinic Judaism. And the person responsible for that, which we're going to talk about here in a moment, is the Apostle Paul. And he is the originator of theology. And he begins to think about what this event, this experience meant, and reflected on this. And so he's the one who began to think very deeply on the meaning. As I said to you before, the Apostle Peter and the other apostles could tell you what happened. They were eyewitnesses. But Paul could tell you what it meant. He had the background and the training. He was highly educated. He was not only educated in steeped in Judaism, and he went to one of the leading rabbinical schools in Jerusalem itself, and he was a student of one of the greatest rabbis of all time, Gamaliel. This is no small thing. So he was among the elite of the best educated of Judaism. That's the Apostle Paul. And the rabbinical Judaism was biblically oriented. They studied carefully the sacred texts of Scripture, and in particular, Torah. And their purpose for doing so was in order that they may fulfill the will of God in their lives. And they felt that they had access to God through these texts. And so they lived and breathed the Torah and the prophets and the writings. And in fact, Most of the Psalms in the Bible, there's 150 of them, usually rabbinical students or rabbis would have that all memorized, as well as most of the Torah memorized. They could just quote this vast amount of literary output. Well, not in part because that's the way the ancients were. The ancients were much better at retaining information orally than we are, because we have become so dependent on taking notes or having a smartphone with access to the internet. We don't have to remember anything now. We got it in a device. Yeah. But there's also the Greek philosophical tradition that originated in Greece. I'm not going to say a whole lot about it, but it was a much more speculative endeavor, and it was about asking questions, understanding the world and how it works. And so the convergence of Greek philosophy with rabbinical Judaism produces Christian theology. So Christian theology is in debt, obviously, to the Christ event, but it's indebted to Greek philosophy, and it's indebted to rabbinical Judaism. So that's what we're going to look at. How did this all begin? And so that's where you need to have your worksheet at this moment. So what is Christian theology, and how did it begin? All theology begins with, or is based upon, actual human religious and or spiritual experience. This is really important to keep in mind. It's not an idea, it's an experience. And so what we think about it is really an afterthought. Wow, what did I just experience here? You know, and in particular, Christian theology is dependent upon a very specific and profound historical event. The word is event. That had a deep and lasting impact. The word is impact. Upon a particular group of people, i.e., the disciples of Jesus of Nazareth. B, the disciples of Jesus had a very profound spiritual encounter which raise their consciousness. We talk about enlightenment. You have an experience that enlightens you. It's a way of elevating your consciousness to a higher level in which you are aware of things that you weren't necessarily aware of before. And so their consciousness of the divine presence in their lives was heightened by their encounter with Jesus of Nazareth. God was not a remote idea. All of a sudden, God is someone who is at work in their midst. So they really believed that when they encountered Jesus, they were encountering divinity. That is, they perceived God acting in a very decisive way in and through Jesus of Nazareth in the following ways. Number one, are you still getting me?
Yes.
Okay. Number one, in his life. There was something about the power of Jesus' personality, his message and actions, that was so compelling that his disciples left everything to follow him and to place their entire hope in him. That's remarkable. It's unprecedented, and it's never been duplicated since. The impact of Jesus upon the lives of his closest disciples cannot be overemphasized. Jesus captured their hearts and imagination. I just wonder what it must have been like to encounter Jesus of Nazareth in that time and place. You know, I often wonder, and it's with great awe that I read these stories of these ordinary people having this encounter, and some great miracle happens. Now, the first miracle of Jesus, according to John, is what? The wedding at Cana, where he transforms ordinary water into extraordinary wine. And that has a lot to say about the theology of that gospel. It's an interesting story that we should explore at some point. But I was having a conversation earlier with Michael, and in the conversation we noted that the very first miracle that Jesus performs in the other three gospels, we'll talk about the earliest one, Mark, was not the wedding at the Cana of Galilee. It was an exorcism. The very so if it wasn't for John's gospel, in which we have the statement that his first miracle was the wedding at Cana of Galilee, we would all be saying today the first miracle of Jesus was to cast out a demon. Isn't that interesting? It's in Mark's gospel and in Matthew and Luke, who borrow from Mark's gospel, they do the same thing. So his very first miracle is a miracle of great manifestation of power, and the exorcism is dramatic. When you read the story of the exorcism that Jesus performs in the synagogue in Capernaum, people were astonished at the power and authority that Jesus demonstrated. Exorcisms are not something that happen in an instant. They take a long time. And so the rabbis and other holy people that would, sages and stuff that would perform exorcisms, it was a long, drawn-out ritual. And interestingly enough, even in the Catholic Church, where we as Catholics recognize the ministry of exorcism and deliverance, it's not something sometimes it takes several hours to participate in such a thing. But with Jesus, and this is what was so astonishing, he just said one word, gone. So not only did he have power over devils and was an exorcist, there were other exorcists around, but he was so damn good at it. You know? I mean, it's just like they couldn't believe the power that he had. So there was something about his life, the power of his personality and his actions and his message, and that he really made an impression on his disciples. It's quite extraordinary. And then he gathers around himself a huge following, multitudes. That word is used so often in the gospel. Multitudes of people would come. He couldn't even get into villages anymore. They had to go out to the deserted places to see him. What's so extraordinary about that is nowadays we can get multitudes together. We can get crowds. It's because of social media, of newspapers and television. So we want to do a big march on Washington? Well, we can do that. In the ancient world, that was next to impossible. So the fact that Jesus could attract so many people, where now they're innumerable and they're talked about in terms of multitudes, this was something that was really unusual. And it would have caught the attention of the local authorities. And they would have been worried about that. So he certainly, in his life, was an extraordinarily powerful person and extraordinarily attractive. Number two, in his death. So when we talk about the Christ event, we're talking about his life, but we're also talking about his death. The vast majority of the narrative in the Gospels is the Passion narrative, which to this day, on the Sunday before Easter, which is Passion Sunday, Palm Sunday, we read the entire Passion is one reading. It's a very long reading, but we read through it. It's part of the liturgy of the church. It is quite a detailed and dramatic account that is given, and there's slight differences between the four Gospels in terms of details, but overall, it's the same story. And the disciples of Jesus were completely unprepared for and bewildered by the death of their master. They didn't see it coming, even though Jesus spoke to them about it. But Jesus said a lot of things they didn't understand. So they were incomprehending. So they were shocked that this happened. To them, his death at the hands of the religious and political authorities was a total calamity. How do we know that? Because they all fled in terror. The impact of Jesus' violent death was not unlike that of other leaders upon their followers. Jesus became a martyr. M-A-R-T-Y-R. He was a martyr. The dramatic events surrounding the death of Jesus in Jerusalem only deepened the devotion of his disciples. And this too captured their imagination and became an integral part of their spirituality. And it has remained such to this day. I remember when the Passion of the Christ came out, and theaters were just jammed. And it came out in this early springtime, and for Stations of the Cross on that Friday, on Good Friday that came out the same year, we never had so many crowds. It's like everybody wanted to do Stations of the Cross, because somehow the suffering and death of Jesus also captures our imagination. It was quite a dramatic story, his death. Now, number three, his resurrection. His resurrection. After the death of Jesus, the disciples began to experience, and this is the uncanny thing, they began to experience the living presence of Jesus again. On several different occasions in the next few weeks, the resurrection appearances of Jesus were a very real and yet unexplainable experience for the disciples. They were certain that they were seeing Jesus of Nazareth alive again. Yet Jesus was somehow different. Somehow he had been transformed. He was alive, but it was a different kind of life. Another level of existence, quite unlike life as we know it in ordinary human experience. It was, and I'm giving you three words, an extraordinary, glorified, resurrected, divine life. Extraordinary, glorified, resurrected, divine life. So, one of the things we need to get away from, and a lot of Christians have this misunderstanding, is that the resurrection wasn't a resuscitation of a corpse. It wasn't like somehow his body came back to life, like Frankenstein. It wasn't like that at all. It was a total transformation of the very physics and chemistry of the body of Jesus. So he was transformed. So that at times he was recognizable, but at other times he wasn't. Isn't that a curious thing in the resurrection stories? I always wonder, what is it that you can't recognize him? Because he was altered, he was changed. And yet, there was something familiar about him. When Mary heard Jesus say to him, when utter her name at the garden tomb, she recognized him immediately. Before that, she thought he was the gardener. And he just says, "Oh, Mary," and she falls to pieces, and she knows it's the Lord. Thomas with the imprint of the nail, so he had the scars of his suffering, even in his glorified state. His body was different in that it passed through walls, so it wasn't even obeying the laws of physics and chemistry that we understand in observing the world today. It was different, very different, and. It would happen, and he would be there with you, and you would have an experience of him, and then he would disappear. And then he would appear somewhere else. So, and this is the record that these early disciples give to us, and they were bewildered by it. They didn't know what to think. In fact, they were scared. And that's why you hear Jesus always saying to them, "Peace be with you. Do not be afraid. Peace be with you." He was saying, "Shalom, shalom, it's okay." And then they were amazed. They were just amazed. So these three things about Jesus, his life, his death, and resurrection, we call this the Christ event. So when I say the Christ event, I'm referring to a specific designation, and any theologian would understand what you were referring to. If you say the Christ event, it is the totality of the impact of this person upon human history in terms of his life, death, and resurrection. The disciples reported their experiences in what has come to be called the apostolic testimony. Apostolic testimony. Let me write that down for you. The apostolic testimony is the eyewitness experience of seeing the resurrected Christ. And this is what this is the story that they pass on. So any thoughts or questions so far? You're having a good time, I hope? Okay. Stop believing in God, Christians, or they become atheists or agnostic. I say, so what's your beef with Jesus? Oh, you know? They have problems with church institutions and religion and religious people and all that. Well, what's wrong with Jesus? Well, he was a good guy, you know. So it just shows you the extent of something about this man. Okay, did we write kerygma down? Did I do that? The apostolic testimony became formally embodied in a proclamation that we call the kerygma. I introduced you to that word last week, didn't I?
Yep.
Yeah. And it's a Greek word that merely means proclamation, preaching. And the apostles had a formula so that everyone could remember what it is. And we talked about that too last week, about the apostolic kerygma. But I want to say something else about this. It's a word that starts with a K. In Greek, it's kappa. You've probably seen that on fraternities and sororities. Okay, kappa. It's the k sound. There are three important K words. And this, I'm giving you something about spirituality. This is not theology. First of all, there is kerygma. That is the proclamation. That is the message. That is the gospel, number one. The next K is called koinonia. 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 I'll write this down. This is a little side thing. I just wanted to... Koinonia. Koinonia is a Greek word that you can translate into the word communion. And communion means one with. To be one with, to share a common life, so to speak. So, the Christ event led to the kerygma and to koinonia, in which we share our lives with Christ and he shares his life with us, and we do so as a community. So kerygma, the proclaimed message, and koinonia, and then there's the third K, and that is kenosis. Did I spell that right? Kenosis. That means to empty yourself of your ego, of your prerogatives, of your rights. And the greatest example of that is Christ himself. He emptied himself of self-interest. He lived more interested in the interests of others than himself. He totally emptied himself. And he becomes our model, because that is the Christian spiritual life. To live as Jesus did and to be able to enter into a kenotic union with him, a kenosis, an emptying of our ego, our false selves. So koinonia, kerygma, and kenosis. You know, that I know I spelled it wrong. Kenosis. The three Ks. And I'm not even charging you extra for that. Okay. Christian theology begins, F, when the Christian community attempts to understand the Christ event. So theology is a human response. It's a human response to a divine action. It is an effort of the community to discover the meaning of a religious and spiritual experience. Gee, the disciples reported their experience, but what did it mean? Theology looks back at a given religious experience and attempts to interpret, interpret that event in order to discover or impart meaning to that event. meaning that transcends the actual historical event and brings it into the present. H, theology is a process. A lot of times, that is lost on many Christians. Christians like to think that all the truth was dropped from heaven all at one time, and there we have it, and we don't have to think anymore. We have it all written down here. It's not how it works. Theology is a process. Theology grows and evolves through reflection and dialogue. Christian theology continues to gain new and greater understanding as it continues to realize the full implications of the Christ event and to apply the meaning of this event to the changing realities of the contemporary world. So every generation that receives the proclamation, the kerygma, engages it, lives it out in their own experience within the community, we are adding something to it. It's growing and developing at a time so that our understanding in our generation is greater than maybe 10 generations ago. But each generation makes a contribution because it's a never-ending conversation. And so this is why things grow and develop throughout time. This is why the church can change. We're not frozen into a particular century, but we are moving forward. And this is why the church must encourage free theological inquiry. When the church becomes heavy-handed and prevents this kind of conversation from going on, we stunt the growth of our theological development and evolution through time, which we must do. In the Roman Catholic Church, a lot of Catholics had a hard time with Vatican II. Because it was a big shift. That was a big change that happened there. Because they thought that the church that they were experiencing in the 1950s is the way it was in the first century, and it wasn't. It grows and changes throughout time, like a plant that is maturing, like a person coming to their full stature. Nothing stays the same. We're all in the process of changing. The important thing, the question asks, is it a good change? Is it adding to the growth and deepening our understanding of that encounter between the human and divine that we find in Christ? And certainly, this is the conversation that begins. Theology is that conversation. And the benefit we can have a conversation with St. Augustine of the 4th century by reading his works, or St. Irenaeus of the 2nd century, or St. Thomas Aquinas, or Martin Luther, or any great contemporary, Karl Rahner. Each generation produces the great minds that can add to and assist us in our ongoing understanding. This is why theological conversation must be encouraged. This is why you're taking this class, right? So you can start to think theologically. To think theologically is not just the prerogative of a few ordained people. It is all of it. It's the whole community. It's our responsibility. And if God has given you a good mind, well, then use it well and be pursuing the most important thing, and that is understanding our faith. So theology is something for everybody. Is that helpful? I'm preaching now.
Yes, and I also feel that it's important to have that experiential as well as the theology, because I've been in churches where they get too caught up in the mental aspect, and there's no spiritual depth to it, and it really bothered me. That's why I had trouble being in Protestant churches.
Yeah,
because they get very cerebral, and it's wonderful. I can appreciate it, but I saw there was something missing in everybody's experience.
It
was painful for me because Well, being the kind of kid I was in the Catholic Church and my faith and all that, and it was deeply experiential, you know, and I missed it. I was longing for it. I mean, even going to communion once a month. I mean, they had once a month communion in one church I was going to, and it was like, oh, you know, and then it was like going through the motions almost. And it wasn't that I was being critical at all. It was just I was seeking something. I was trying to find it, and I found it at home in my prayer life rather than in the church. There was community there, and it was fun. We had moving lights, and we did this and we did that. But as far as the actual time of gathering, it was that deep experience I was missing so badly. And so when I walked into St. Matthew's that first Sunday that I was here, when was it, a year ago we were here, and January the 10th.
Wow.
Both of us had that deep, profound experience that we were seeking so badly. So anyway, I just had to bring that in because I think it always has to go hand in hand for it to be a balance, learning the theology, but also having that deep, profound experience consistently as best you can. You know, I think it brings everything to a unified perspective, I think.
Well said, Adelia. Well said.
Okay.
Because really, theology is not really theology if you don't have an experience. It's just a head trip. It's just like an idea. So really, if you don't have an experience of God, then you have nothing really to say about it. You know, you're just building on further ideas of what you like to think, but the experience always has priority. You have to have that experience. Rufus Mosley, who was a great Christian mystic of the 20th century, says that you need to be a first-hander, not a second-hander. You need to have your own direct experience of the presence of God in your life in Christ. You just can't spiritually live off other people's experience. You got to have your own experience. And theology is really has to have the two components. You have to have the intellectual ability to think through these things and reflect on them, but you also have to have the experience of the divine. The two go together. And I even though what I'm saying here is not an improvement at all what you've said, because no, really, you've said it so well. That's why growing up in the Baptist church, which was a good experience for me. I'm glad I was raised that way in a devoutly Baptist home, and I learned the Bible and I learned to love Jesus. I think that's pretty good, and I love the hymn singing. And when I was baptized, I was 11 and a half years old, and they put me under. I knew I was baptized. So all of that I credit the Baptists with. They gave me my faith in Jesus, but it stopped there, and I wanted something more. And so I got involved in the charismatic renewal because I wanted to experience more of God. So I got involved in the charismatic renewal and experienced those things. But I wanted more because I realized Christianity was so much bigger than what I grew up with. Although what I grew up with was fine, I wanted more. I was hungry for more. And that's why I explored other Christian traditions, and it finally led me to Catholicism. And that's where I made my home. But it's an ongoing daily adventure. And I'm preaching again. But thank you, Adelia. You inspire me. Okay. So.
May I make a comment?
Yes.
I think that it's perhaps difficult for some people who hear about others who have these intense personal experiences and yet have not had such an experience themselves.
Yeah.
And I'd like to speak on their behalf for just a second.
Yeah.
Because one of the things that happened to me in terms of my call to become ordained in a sacramental ministry was the realization that Christ can be shared personally and experientially in the Eucharist. And even if you haven't had one of these so-called dramatic religious experiences, Christ is present with us there in the sanctuary when we experience Eucharist. And for some people, that's the way that Christ is known, the most meaningful way that Christ is known. And not all of us are going to have those intense experiences. How we encounter Christ is due to the grace of God.
Exactly.
And one of the things I think we really have to remember, that I have to remember always, is the little sentence, "My grace is sufficient for you."
Mm-hmm.
You know, and even in our doubting and our questioning, God's grace is working on us individually because He loves us so much, and He knows what we need more than we know what we need. And we need to keep that in mind.
Well said. A lot of wisdom coming out of this group tonight. Thank you very much, Mother Diane. Okay, where are we on our notes? Oh, theology is a process. Theology grows and evolves through reflection and dialogue. Christian theology continues to gain new and greater understanding as it continues to realize the full implications of the Christ event and to apply the meaning of this event to the changing realities of the contemporary world. So we do adapt to the changing conditions of the world. In other words, we're trying to see, bring to what is happening today a perspective that comes from our experience of the historic Jesus and of the resurrected Christ. So Christian theology deals with the following major areas of inquiry in regard to the Christ event. And by the way, I'm giving you now an outline of what you can expect in the coming lessons. Number one, Christology. We'll be getting to that soon. Who is Jesus Christ? What kind of being is He? Is He human or divine or both? What is the relationship between the human and divine in Christ? Those are the questions that have to do with Christology. Now, number two, should I write that on the board? Christology? You got it. It's Christology. Okay. And this one I better write down. The next one is soteriology. It's from the Greek word soter, which means salvation. I want to see if I can spell it in English. I-O-L-G. Soteriology, the work of Christ. It's talking about the work of Christ. Just what did His life, death, and exaltation accomplish? What does this action of Christ do for us? If Jesus is our Savior, how is He saving us? What are we being saved from? Just what is salvation and why do we need it? Those questions have to do with soteriology.
Excuse me.
Yes.
The Greek word?
Yeah.
What's the base of it?
Soter is the Greek word. It's a Greek word that means to be delivered, to be saved, to be rescued. And it's the study of our salvation. The study of our salvation. Number three, we have pneumatology. It's spelled like pneumonia. And pneumatology is the study of the Holy Spirit. Who or what is the Holy Spirit? What is the Holy Spirit's relationship to Christ, to the process of salvation, and to us? So soteriology. We'll be getting into that. Then number four, ecclesiology. Ecclesiology Oh, I got it. I almost made it. Ecclesiology. It's from the Greek word ekklesia. Ekklesia comes from the Greek word I keep transposing into English when I'm
Is this on the test?
No, ekbalo. It means to be That's not it. I better just write it in English. How about that? Okay. Oh, kaleo, which means to be called out. Remember when you were in elementary school and there had to be an assembly and all the students came out and met for assembly? That's what it means. Ecclesiology means a gathering of the whole, bringing everybody together to assemble and to be in one another's presence. That's what we mean by ecclesia, which means church. We translate it into our language church. So ecclesiology is the study of the church. Who and what is the church? As followers of Jesus, just what is our relationship to him and to one another? Is the church a club or an institution or something more? Does the church have a role in Christ's saving work? If so, just what are the saving actions of the church? The sacraments, what are they and what do they accomplish? And who is and who can be in the church? All of those questions fall under the area of ecclesiology. Eschatology is another area. Eschatology is E-S-C-H, eschatology. Eschatology. This is one that excites a lot of people. It's basically, what's next? What does it mean when it is said we are at the end of the age? Is Christ coming again? If so, what will happen? Will we be raptured? Does the world come to an end? Is the earth going to be destroyed? Will things be different then? What about the afterlife? Just what is heaven, hell, and purgatory? All those questions of what's next is the study of eschatology. And then finally, I have here moral theology. Moral theology, number 6. Moral theology, how should we then live? What kind of impact does the Christ event have on human behavior? In what way should we conduct ourselves in regard to our relationship with others and to God? What does God expect from us? Just what is the Christian ethic? Are moral values absolute and unchanging, or are they relative and subject to change from one time to another, from one culture to the next? So moral theology is, you can see, is another important area of Christian theology. Now, I've given you the major branches of Christian theology, but there are also a lot of other more minor branches. Like, there is what is called anthropology. Anthropology, you thought it was the study of bones, but originally anthropology was the study of what is humanity. And then later on, it branched off on its own. This is why theology is called the queen of the sciences. Because everything began in the universities of Europe because they were schools of theology. And then certain areas would break off and become their own discipline. Okay. Now, are we on page 4? Mm-hmm. Okay. The development of Christian theology, page 4. We got through the introduction. Here we are, Roman numeral 1, the Apostle Paul. In the Apostle Paul, three major cultural streams of the first century Western worlds converge. The worlds of Judaism, he was a Jew, he was a Jewish rabbi. The Roman Empire, and third, Hellenism. How many remember what Hellenism is? Hellenism. The Greeks called their country Hellas. Okay, they still do to this day. We call it Greece. They call it Hellas. And Greek people are called Hellenes. So, that Hellenistic culture, that Greek culture, the Roman Empire and Judaism converge in the person of Paul. Paul spoke Greek. He had conversations. It's recorded in the Bible. He had conversations with Greek philosophers. He could quote the Greek poets. He grew up in Tarsus, which was a Greek university city, which was an academic center of the Greek intellectual world. He was familiar with the Greeks and their philosophies and their way of thinking and their art and their drama and their theater. He was familiar with all those things. Paul was also a Roman citizen, which was unusual. Not many people were citizens of Rome. When we say of ourselves that I'm an American citizen, we're thinking I belong to a certain nation. In the ancient world, there were no nation states. You were a citizen of a city. So Rome was a city. It happened to be a city that grew more powerful than all other cities and could then create an empire by overcoming all these other cities. And so to be a citizen of Rome is to be a citizen of the city of Rome. And because Rome was the top dog, it was the city that ran the empire and controlled everyone else's lives. And so all roads lead to Rome and all wealth leads to Rome. All political power, all military power was centered in Rome. Then being a citizen of the city of Rome was quite prestigious and gave you a lot of freedom and power, and you were not subject to the same laws as the rest of the members of society were. Paul was a Roman citizen at a time when that was rare, because the Romans would give out the gift of citizenship to people who helped them and served them well. And Paul inherited, it's also inherited. So Paul inherited his Roman citizenship from his father. Now we do know that his father lived in Tarsus and that his father was a tent maker. We do know that. Paul was a tent maker by trade. So rabbis not only could do the rabbi thing, but they could also have a trade and work at it to support themselves. So how is it that a tent maker in Tarsus would receive Roman citizenship? Well, you remember the story of the battle between Octavian, who would become Caesar Augustus, and Antony and Cleopatra? Do you remember that story? It was a civil war. Who was going to control the empire? Was it going to be Octavius, or was it going to be Antony and Cleopatra? Well, we know how the story turned out. We know what happened to Antony and Cleopatra. They ended up committing suicide. They lost. However, when Caesar Augustus had his great armies and he was going to go and invade Egypt and defeat Antony and Cleopatra, while the Roman armies were encamped there around Tarsus, what do Roman soldiers need when you're out in the field? Shelter, tents. And so the tent makers, who were Jewish, in Tarsus, made the tents for the Roman army. This was so important and valuable to their success that apparently Caesar Augustus gave the tent makers, or at least one of them, Roman citizenship. You see how he got it? Yeah. So Paul was a Roman citizen. So he was a Roman citizen. He had the protection of the laws of the Roman Empire. He was a Jewish rabbi, and he was someone who was familiar with the Greek language and Greek culture and philosophy. He was a Jew by race, a native of Tarsus, a Roman citizen. That's a quote from Acts 21:29. Now, I'm quoting Paul, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, which meant that he spoke Aramaic, from an Aramaic-speaking family. Paul, whose other name was Saul. Saul is a Jewish name. It's an old name from the nation of Israel. The first king of Israel was King Saul, Saul. And Paul is a Roman name. So Paul, when he was in Jewish circles, would go by Saul. When he was in Gentile circles, he would go by his Roman name, Paul. So this was not unusual. There were many others who had a Roman name, a Greek name, plus their Jewish name. So Paul, whose other name was Saul, was a Jew from a city called Tarsus in Cilicia. And Cilicia is right, it's in southern Turkey, near the Syrian border. Situated in the southern shore of what has come to be called Asia Minor. Today, this part of the world is southern Turkey near the Syrian border. Oh, I just quoted myself. Okay. Number one, although the family of Saul did not reside in the homeland of their ancestors, which at the time was called Palestine by the Romans, they were part of a large Jewish community in Tarsus. that had strong connections with the land of Israel. Like the Jews of Palestine, this particular Jewish community within Tarsus spoke the Aramaic language. Aramaic. In the New Testament, Aramaic is called Hebrew, but it's really, they don't mean Hebrew, they mean Aramaic, which is closely related to Hebrew. So he spoke the Aramaic language, so he had a strong connection with the homeland. Aramaic was a Semitic language derived from Hebrew that was spoken by the people of Israel in the centuries preceding the time of Jesus and well into the first century. Jesus was a Palestinian Jew who spoke Aramaic, a Palestinian Jew who spoke Aramaic. Aramaic is often referred to in the New Testament documents as Hebrew. Number two, Saul came from a very traditional, that is, a very religious Jewish home. As a young man, he was sent to study his religion in the rabbinical school. Rabbinical, I have it up here, rabbinical school of Gamaliel. Gamaliel. Wait, I'm missing a word. I'm missing a letter. Gamaliel in Jerusalem. Saul was of a particular sect of Judaism known as the Pharisees. So he was a Pharisee. You know those guys that Jesus was always arguing with? He was a Pharisee. And the only two forms of Judaism that survived the destruction of the temple were the Pharisees and the Christians. So, the Pharisees were those who viewed their lives as being set apart for the law or the Torah. They were noted for their careful observance of all the instructions of the Mosaic religion. That is, the Torah. The word Torah means instruction. Sometimes we translate it as the law, the instruction, or the Torah, T-O-R-A-H. The Pharisees had a strong appeal to the Jews of the first century, and their interpretation of the Mosaic religion remained a strong influence upon the development of rabbinical Judaism in the centuries following Christ. In fact, the Jews of today are really descendants of the Pharisees. They survived. Although a Pharisee, Saul had a close relationship with the high priest and the Sadducees. The Sadducees were a different party. They were not Pharisees, but they were the ones that ran the temple. Through his connection with the Sanhedrin, S-A-N-H-E-D-R-I-N, the Sanhedrin, which was the great council in Jerusalem of the elders, the scribes, and the priests. By the way, we know that Paul was employed by them. You know, he was a very young man at this time. And so, you know, he was probably like an intern who showed a lot of promise. It has even been suggested that Saul might have been a scribe. You know, the scribes and Pharisees. And I think he was a scribe. A specialist in the study of the Torah. Okay, that's his Jewish background. B, do you speak Greek? That's a question that someone asked Paul in the Acts of the Apostles. Saul was fluent in the Greek language, which was the official language of the Roman Empire at that time. Number one, Tarsus was a Greek city, an important city in the world that was dominated by Hellenistic culture. Hellenistic culture.
So, would you say that they lived in like in a an ethnic, not ghetto, but enclave?
Well, yeah, ghetto would be the right word. And it we think of a ghetto as being a place that's devastated by poverty. But a ghetto was a place where it was has a homogeneous population. Mm-hmm. And let's say there's a great cosmopolitan city and there's the Italian neighborhood. You experienced this back east more prominently than here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so there was the Italian neighborhood and that's where all the Italians live. And
predominantly Italian.
Yeah, and that's where, yeah. Yeah. Then there's the Irish neighborhood, and then there's the Polish neighborhood. Well, that's Paul was living and grew up in a Jewish ghetto in Tarsus, if you will.
Okay.
Because you couldn't associate intimately with the Gentiles. You couldn't eat with them. You couldn't have them over to your house. And you couldn't go over to their house. You would render yourself impure. So you had to live. They did live a separate existence. Although they would encounter Gentiles in the work in daily life by going to the market or in commerce or in working or in contracting jobs and that sort of thing. So they weren't totally separated. Okay, I completely forgot where I was. Oh, thank you. Tarsus was noted for, among other things, their numerous Hellenistic schools. Hellenistic schools. So Tarsus was a city of learning, of educational institutions of the time. Wasn't there one of the ancient philosophers that was from Tarsus? Before Paul, time of Paul? Any of them?
Probably, I would have to.
Yeah. I didn't mean to put you on the spot. The reason I put Mother Diane on the spot when it comes to things like philosophy and stuff is because she taught it for years. Okay. I completely lost one.
The schools of Tarsus were centers of Hellenistic learning, I think is the word.
Culture. Yeah, I said culture here, but learning is also good, and provide many of the leading educators of the upper classes throughout the empire at that time. So they were producing teachers, educators. Okay, number three, the writings of Paul betray not only a familiarity with Greek language, but also some exposure to some leading Greek writers. Although Paul does not seem to have much of an interest in Hellenistic thought, he really didn't, he is best understood in the terms of the Jewish culture in which he was immersed. Number four, however, Hellenism was the dominant world culture of his time, and certainly he was familiar and affected with Greek ideas. C, the man is a Roman citizen, as they were getting ready to beat Paul. Uh-oh, because Roman citizens can't be beaten. Paul was a citizen of the city of Rome. This meant that he possessed special privileges and rights under Roman law. Roman citizenship was granted as a favor from Rome and was difficult to come by. Not everyone in the Roman Empire was a citizen. To possess Roman citizenship placed one at a special status within Roman society. Paul was a Roman citizen, not because it was granted to him, or as was often the case, purchased through bribery, but rather inherited from his own father. Roman citizenship could be passed on to one's heirs.
Rome had lots of rabble. Were all those people Roman citizens, or were only a certain class of people citizens?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. That's a good question. I kind of think if you spoke Latin, so you were of that ethnic group, and you were born and lived in the city of Rome, you would be a Roman. Yeah, so, okay. But I really don't know. Well, and that rabble, by the way, the emperor always took care of.
Yeah.
I mean, Rome brought in a lot of wealth, and it was distributed among the citizenry. So, and to keep the rabble entertained and not asking too many questions, the Roman emperors created the great games, you know, built the Colosseum, you know, to keep the crowds happy. It was free admission. You know, go, watch the show, enjoy your life. Don't be thinking about what the emperor is doing right now. Okay. Oh, thank you. I'm glad you're here, Polly. Keep me straight. Saul was trying to destroy the church. Saul was a persecutor of the Jesus movement. He despised it because Paul was bright enough to understand that the Jesus movement, at this time called the Way, was a threat to Judaism, was a threat to the temple worship. It had to be eradicated. Paul was a young rabbi and he was a fanatic. Just the kind of guy that can prove useful to those who are really holding the power in the Sanhedrin, right? Mm-hmm. You need someone to do your dirty work.
Yep.
Paul was enough of a fanatic and young enough to be very useful to them. So Saul was trying to destroy the church. Saul was a persecutor of the Jesus movement. Number one, the Jesus movement among Palestinian Jews was tolerated by the authorities in Jerusalem. However, as the Jesus movement spread to the Hellenistic Jewish community, remember we talked about this a little bit last week, the Sanhedrin became quite concerned and actively opposed the movement among the Hellenistic Jews. This was because of the radical development in the message and aggressive preaching of the Hellenistic Christian community. Their preaching was openly critical of not only the temple authorities, as the Palestinian Jews would do, but also the temple cult itself. What need do we have of a temple and its sacrifices? Isn't Jesus the final sacrifice? We don't need it anymore. We don't need to, God doesn't need a house to live in. So what use is a temple? This does not make people who are supporters of institutional established religion happy, because there's a temple economy. So, you know, this was this was more radical than what Peter and John and James were saying. This was an extremism. Their preaching was openly critical, not only temple authorities, but the temple cult itself. Stephen was among the most radical of these new preachers of the way. So what happens? Stephen is arrested and then executed under the auspices of the Sanhedrin. It is here that we are first introduced to the character Saul of Tarsus in the martyrdom of Stephen. It seems from the text that Saul was actually presiding. You know, he was holding the cloaks, you know, of the people who were throwing the stones. In other words, he was representing the Sanhedrin, and it meant that this was a colloquial expression. He was there authorizing him. Because, here, let me hold your cloak while you throw stones in the name of the Sanhedrin on this heretic, Stephen, who dares to speak against the temple. By the way, this was a lynch mob, because it was illegal for the Sanhedrin to enact capital punishment. Only the Roman authorities could do that. That's why they had to go to Pontius Pilate and do all this palace intrigue to get Jesus put to death, because it's unlawful according to Roman law. Only the Romans could execute, not the Jewish Sanhedrin. But they became so enraged at Stephen that they rushed out as a mob, and there with them presiding over it was this radical, fanatical, young rabbi, Saul of Tarsus, and he's holding the cloaks while they throw the stones.
But he wouldn't see that it was his, was it beneath him to throw a stone himself as a rabbi?
I don't know. Maybe. Like a priest wouldn't be shooting a gun, you know? I don't know.
Passing the ammunition is not the same thing.
Yeah, so, but he was certainly there, and he was present, and Luke says, and he heartily approved of what they were doing. So
why were the Hellenistic Jews so more radical and aggressive than Palestinian Jews?
That's a good question, but because they were more worldly, because they came from other parts of the world, they saw many cultures, they spoke the Greek language. So I think that they were more prone to new ideas.
Could it be also that they did not have the cultural, same respect for the power structure of the Sadducees and the Pharisees at the time?
Well, and the Palestinian Jews looked down on the Hellenistic Jews. Mm-hmm. There was a natural prejudice. You're not really one of us, because you left. You should be living here in the land of our ancestors. Yeah, so there was already a tension between these two groups. Okay, so I completely lost my way.
We're down at the bottom of 2 and just finished it.
Okay, we finished 2?
So we're on page 6.
The last line. Approved, I think.
Approved.
Is that the word?
Approved.
Oh, that's right.
The last word in the last.
Stephen became the first martyr, and then Saul, number three, we're on number three, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Saul was then authorized officially. They found their man, the Sanhedrin, the great Supreme Council of Judaism, to carry out a severe persecution of the followers of the Jesus movement within the Hellenistic Jewish community. They said, don't bother any of the Palestinian Jews, or, you know, Aramaic-speaking Jews. So leave Paul and Peter, not Paul, leave Peter and James and John alone, but go after the Hellenistic. They weighed their political capital, and they felt they could go after the Hellenistic Jewish community because they were looked down upon by the most of the population anyway. You see?
They probably think the older ones who were closer to the tradition,
yes,
might be won back then to the temple, whereas the Hellenistic crowd is newer to the whole thing, so had less value.
Well, that's interesting. So in other words, hey, maybe we can persuade the less offensive followers of Jesus who were Palestinian like us to come back to the fold, so to speak.
But they were still attending temple.
They were still, oh, yeah, that's right.
You know, you got to keep that in mind.
They were attending temple. They were not speaking against the temple. You're absolutely right about that.
They were supporting it.
They were supporting the temple, yeah. Okay, Saul was then authorized by the Sanhedrin, and he goes after the Hellenistic Jewish community. He was given actual letters of authorization, and he went around and he would, you know, they didn't have, it was like a warrant. He could go in and to their homes and arrest them and bring them out in chains. He was like overseeing the arrest of many of these followers of Jesus. Saul was motivated by religious zeal, Z-E-A-L. His religious devotion to his ancestral religion led him to make the determined effort to eradicate this new religious movement, which he perceived as a threat to the traditions of Judaism. And he was right. It was a threat. It was going to change the whole program. Many of the followers of the way, I use the word the way because at this time, they're not called Christians yet. They're Jews, but they were different than other Jews, and they were because they were following the way.
Is there an Aramaic word for the way?
Oh, there is, but I don't know what that is. Boy, that would be an interesting question. Google that and see if the Aramaic word for the way, in quotes, that would be interesting. So many of the followers of the way among the Hellenistic community went into hiding, and many fled to avoid Saul's persecution. Saul received special authorization from the Sanhedrin to pursue the fleeing followers of Jesus and set out with temple guard. He had his own little militia with him for Damascus. Now, Damascus is to the northeast, and it's the major city of Syria. He appeared to me, E. Saul becomes a follower of Jesus. This is astonishing. Saul encounters the resurrected Jesus on the road to Damascus. You all know the story. He's struck blind, and here's what Jesus says, the resurrected Christ says to Paul. Paul is struck blind, he's on the ground, and all of a sudden hears a voice from heaven, and the voice says, Paul, or Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? If you do it to the least of these of my followers, you've done it unto me. Already is implicit the idea of the body of Christ that Paul would later be responsible for developing. So when you touch one of Jesus' little ones, you're persecuting Jesus. Why are you persecuting me? Dramatic story. This encounter led to his dramatic conversion, and he becomes a leading proponent of the Jesus movement. Although he's not readily accepted by the other Christians or followers of Jesus because they're thinking,
who is this guy?
Yeah, he was persecuting. Come on, he's trying to infiltrate us. Mm-hmm. It's a trick. Set apart from me, Saul. Saul is a teacher in the Christian community at Antioch of Syria. From there, he is sent from the Antiochian church to be a missionary. Saul, who now goes by his Roman name, Paul, spends the next several years of his life establishing Christian communities throughout Asia Minor and Greece. He becomes the most influential and successful missionary of Christianity of his time. Ultimately, his missionary endeavors and the controversies created by his preaching activities led to his arrest in Jerusalem and imprisonment in Rome. G, I'm writing to you. The legacy of Paul is most felt in the many letters he wrote to the various Christian communities of his time. Most of his letters were written to communities that were founded by him. The purpose of these writings was pastoral in nature. From these letters, we are able to derive much of the theological thinking of Paul, the apostle. Theological thinking of Paul, the apostle. Paul is the first New Testament writer. His writings are earlier than the Gospels, which surprises people when they hear that the first time. And his writings make up more than half of the written material contained within the New Testament. H, Paul's stature as a theologian is enormous in comparison with the other New Testament writers of his time. Only one other comes close, and that's John in the Gospel that bears his name. Paul was uniquely qualified to engage the Christian message in theological expression. He was able to think through many of the implications of the Christ event, implications of the Christ event, and to discover important meanings that became the material for subsequent theological development within the Christian movement. In fact, every theologian studies Paul. Okay. Any thoughts?